All right, hello everybody. Welcome to AP 8.4, Acid-Base Reactions and Buffer Creations. This vodcast is actually late in the unit of 8 for me, late in the 8, look at that. For me, I actually have taught by now 8.8, 8.9, and 8.10, so when I'm referring to Hendy-Hossi and buffers and I'm mentioning we previously discussed this, that's why. So if you're somebody from YouTube who's watching this and isn't just one of my students, that's why it's out of order. So let's go. So first thing we're going to spend, and most of the time we're going to spend on here today, is talking about the actual titration, the actual manipulation, the actual reaction of these acid-base reactions and what that does as far as our stoic, or maybe even our ice tables. Too cold, too cold. So let's do it to it, Lars. So first off and foremost, ladies and gentlemen, we got to just address the idea of what the heck is acid-base neutralization, right? So acid-base neutralization is, as we've discussed so far over and over and over again, that hydronium H plus is a non-common common ion for hydroxide. OH minus, just like hydroxide, OH minus is a not common common ion for hydronium H plus. So if I looked at something like HBr, a strong acid, hydrobromic acid reacting with NaOH, a strong base, and sodium hydroxide, if we did the full Audi's bond, if we did the full double replacement reaction thing, the Audi's bond and the Innes bond, we would get the following products. We would get a NaBr, a sodium bromide aqueous species product, and actually that HOH comes together to create liquid water. So that neutralization, believe it or not, because you do have, remember, anytime we see aqueous, these would be all ions all the time. And when we create a new state of matter, which we do, when the hydroxide and the hydronium come together, they create liquid water. Remember, way back in the day, earlier this year, we discussed the fact that anytime you create any new species, any new substance, you actually could and should represent it via what's called a net ionic equation. So for all acid-base neutralization, if it's strong on strong, ladies and gentlemen, I don't care what the strong acid is, I don't care what the strong base is, the net ionic equation always and forever for that acid-base neutralization is as such. The hydronium from the acid is going to react with the hydroxide from the base to neutralize each other and create what's called water. Now, those other NaBr ions that are in solution, to bring this back to earlier in the year when we discussed ions and precipitation reactions, those NaBr ions are just spectator ions, but even deeper than that, in this unit, we should also be able to say that those Na ions, those spectator ions that come from Na, are from NaOH, which that was a strong base. And so those Na ions are actually a very weak conjugate acid, right? They would be, in theory, H plus donors. That Br minus, that came from a very strong acid. So that Br minus, because it came from a very strong acid, that's actually a very weak conjugate base. So although those are spectator ions, those spectator ions come from very strong parents, so they are very weak conjugates. And so therefore, ladies and gentlemen, those ions do not affect our pH at all at equilibrium or at the neutralization. So the reason why usually students always say, oh, acid-base neutralization, pH is always 7. Well, not always. Of course, we got to go deeper. So if it is an acid-base neutralization for strong acid, strong base, and it's equal moles, which again doesn't mean equal molarity, it means equal moles. Now, if it is equal molarity, it's got to be equal volumes of equal molarity. But if it's different volumes or different molarities, it still can be equal moles. But if it's strong on strong, guys, and it gives us this net ionic equation we see right here, that's why the pH should be 7. Now, let me introduce you to, and I would suggest that you do pause the video here and sketch this real quick, but let me introduce you to the first greatest thing ever, which is called a titration curve. We're going to spend a lot of time on these titration curves over the next few days. And you should be very comfortable and very confident and very much okay with the overall shape of this curve and being able to say that this is a strong acid that is being titrated by a strong base. You know it is a strong acid for a couple of reasons. One, the pH that we started with, and then as we're going to learn and as you're going to see as these slides continue, the overall shape. Now, this again is a strong acid that I am titrating with a strong base. So as I sit there and I add a little drip drip and a little drip drip and a little drip drip, I don't know, maybe something you just recently did in the lab. Now, if we saw an indicator, you'd see the indicator go pink and disappear, pink, disappear, pink, disappear, pink, disappear. All throughout this part, this early part of the titration curve, That's what you were seeing the other day, is the pink then disappearing because we still have a ton of acid in that solution. And those acids, every little drip drip, they are going to eat up one of those H pluses that's in solution. We're going to see that net ionic equation I was just talking about. Now, very, very important moment here. What you will realize, and for those of you that even have great titration skills, and I was busting your chops during the lab the other day, for those of you that did add just a teeny tiny little drop and all of a sudden the solution went from clear to like dark pink, it's not your fault. Look at the curve here, ladies and gentlemen, and specifically look at the slope, how it's almost infinite, the slope here, as we approach what's called the equivalence point. Well, the equivalence point is also, we should be timing it up in our labs near that end point where the indicator flips. Notice that for a strong on strong, the equivalence point pH is always also going to always, always, always be a pH of 7. Because at that equivalence point, I've added enough hydroxide, I've added enough OH minuses to eat up all of the H pluses that I had originally in solution. And so all we have at solution is water. And we do have those spectator ions, but remember, those spectator ions are weak conjugates, so they do not affect the pH. So it's a very, 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 very important moment that you know going forward that at the equivalence point, what the equivalence point represents, ladies and gentlemen, is the moment, it's the equivalence, the equal and equilibrium, or sorry, the equivalence point, not equilibrium, the equal and the equivalence point is that I've added enough titrant, in this case base, to eat up all of the original sample, to fully react, to fully push that sample to completion. So however much OH I've added, I must have had that amount of HA, which for a strong acid is also the H+. That is also the amount of H+ I had originally. So we're going to use those equivalence points to actually calculate how much of the unknown solution we had moving forward. Okay. Well, what if we don't have the world's most perfect reaction of all time? What if we don't have this situation where we have a perfect amount of acid acting with a perfect amount of base? Well, what that now means, ladies and gentlemen, is that we're going to have an excess reactant. What that now means is, again, I don't care if it's perfectly even Steven, I still have the same net ionic equation. But now if I don't have the same number of moles, either same volume, same molarity, or different volumes, different molarities that give us the same moles, now we are going to have an excess reactant. Now I am going to have either H pluses left over or OH minuses left over. So in order to determine the pH of that solution, I've got to figure out what's in excess. And then believe it or not, whatever's in excess, this then just becomes everything that we've been doing. This now just becomes either a strong acid or strong base problem. So unfortunately, we're going to have to follow the same like five-step process. Now, you don't really have to show these steps, but this is just what you have to do. And however you can do your stoichiometry and however you like to do your stoichiometry, if it's multiple choice, however you can mentally think through it. But what we're going to have to do, like we have to do always with all limiting and excess reactant, is we've got to figure out who the hell the LR is and who the heck the ER is. Who's our limiting, who's our excess, so that I then know how to finish the problem. So first things first, the only thing that we can do is compare moles to each other. And so they're going to give us a volume and a molarity. And if you remember, molarity is mole per liter. So if they give me the volume and they give me the molarity, I can find my moles by multiplying volume times molarity, because volume times molarity will just equal moles. So we're going to take the volume in liters of the acid they gave us, multiply times the molarity of acid they give us, volume of base they give us times molarity of base they give us, and then we're just going to compare the two to each other, because remember, as per our net ionic equation, and because acids always dissociate in a stepwise one by one by one manner, it's always going to be a one by one ratio. So we're then just going to subtract the moles of hydronium from moles of hydroxide, and whatever we have extra of, that is going to be our excess. We're going to divide those moles of excess left, and here's the key, guys. We got to divide it by the total volume in liters, after all, so that we can find the total volume, well, no, sorry, the total molarity of that species left. From there, just calculate your pH or POH as desired, whatever the question's asking and whatever solution you're starting with. So this then just becomes everything we've done in that 8.2, 8.3 vodcast that we've already covered earlier this unit. All right, so going to kick you into the deep end here a little bit, ladies and gentlemen. Those of you on Edpuzzle, I'm going to pause it. But if you took good notes on that previous slide, just follow those steps and see if you can do this. Now, I got a couple extra little Sneakosaurus Rexes in here, so don't beat yourself up if you don't get it. Those of you on YouTube, I would pause it, try it on your own, but here we go. All right, so as I manipulate this equation, now already our concentrations are pretty darn close, and those volumes are very different, so I'm getting a little bit nervous about whether or not this is actually a perfectly even Steven 7.0 neutralization. So as I jumped into it, I took the volume of hydrobromic acid. I just always love to do my acids first. It doesn't matter whether you do acids or bases first. Technically, they gave you the base info. If you want to do that first, go with your bad self. But I turned the volume 35 milliliters into 0.035, and I do keep the zero because that is significant. Liters of hydrobromic acid, multiply it times its molarity, which has 3 sig figs. So I get 3 sig figs worth of moles of hydronium. Now, technically, I'm being lazy here. I should have a one-step conversion out of moles of HBr into moles of H, but because it is a monatomic acid, we already know what it is. Open-ended, I would show that work. But that's going to be my moles of H. I'm going to do the same thing for the volume of sodium hydroxide. I'm going to turn that volume into liters by dividing by 1,000, multiply it by the molarity. And again, technically, I should have a 1 mole NaOH to 1 mole OH conversion factor there. Now, as I subtract the two, I can already see the OH is greater than the H, but I subtract the two to find out how much. I lose a sig fig here because all we care about are decimal digits. And so I have 0.0022 moles of OH left over. Now, that's not a ton, but I do have more base than I do acid. But having moles doesn't help me, so I'm going to divide that by the volume. The total volume, last time I checked, 55.0. plus 35.0 is going to give me a 90.0. So I do have to keep all three of those sig figs in mind, divide it by the into the two sig figs of the solution. Now, as if that wasn't enough, on top of all of that, I actually have more base than I do acid. So because I have more base than I do acid, I've actually got to find the pOH first. So if you got 1.62, I love your heads at, but what you actually found was the pOH, not the pH. Plus, guys, think about that. You're talking about a solution that has more hydroxide than it does acid, and you're telling me the pH is below 7? That shouldn't make any sense. From there, I can, because they didn't specify, so I assume that this is at 25 degrees Celsius. So if you don't specify a temperature other than 25, it's safe to assume 25. So I can subtract that from 14, and that's a much more comfortable pH. A pH of 12.38, which is above 7 on the pH scale, tells me the solution is basic. It tells me I have more acid than I do base in the solution. So that's a nice pH. That's a spicy meatball. If you got that question, you should definitely be proud peacocking it, guys, because that is a legit question. All right, so an opportunity to bounce back. Same reaction, same equation, same net ionic equation, same strong on strong, but different volumes and different molarities this time. So same thing, follow those five steps to freedom, try and calculate the pH. YouTubers, pause it. Edpuzzle, here comes your pause. All right, so again, when I break this one down, we're going to go through this one quicker because it's just like the previous one. Multiply your volumes times your molarities, volumes times molarities. You can see you have more moles of H than you do have moles of OH this time. So whoo! I actually have a slightly acidic solution. I subtract the moles of H from the moles, sorry, the moles of OH from the moles of H, and I see that I do have moles of H in excess. Divided by the total volumes, I added up my 36.9 to my 18.8, keep your 3 sig figs, and now you get a molarity of 0.12 molar H. Because this is an acid, I can go right to pH, and that's what they wanted. So pH is the negative log of 1.2. When I plug in that into my calculator, I get a pH of 0.92. And yeah, buddy, this was a strong acid after all. The pH should be less than 7. And it turns out to be. Okay, less than 7. So that doesn't make logical sense. Now that that's nice and warm and fuzzy and comfy, well, let's look at the fun that comes our way with this nonsense that is called weak acid with base titration. So again, we will get into this a little bit deeper over the next few days. But while we got you here, let's go. So we're going to see a similarity here, ladies and gentlemen, but a powerful difference in the acid-base neutralization for a weak acid in comparison to the acid-base neutralization for a strong acid. When you neutralize a weak acid with a strong base, so instead of using a strong acid, I still use that same strong base of NaOH. What's going to happen here is we do still have one spectator ion, but we don't have two spectator ions. We do include and we do keep the conjugate base. We do keep that, ladies and gentlemen, in our net ionic equation. A minus does stay in our net ionic equation because that A minus is not fully dissociated here. Remember, in our reactant, normally that AQ, I think of it as AQ, I think of it separate. But remember, that acid stays together as a weak acid. That's why it's weak. So technically, your A minus is different. That nitrite ion is different as nitrite, whereas in the reactant, it is not nitrite. It is bonded to that H and it stays together. So unlike our strong acid, strong base, acid base neutralization net ionic equation, say that five times fast, where it's just hydronium plus just hydroxide yields just water, our weak acid-base net ionic equation is going to actually have some equilibrium, and the weak acid creates a strong conjugate base, and so that must stay in solution. Now, with that also creates a massive, massive, massive difference, ladies and gentlemen. Even though we could still fully neutralize the weak acid, we actually don't get a neutral pH of 7. If you perfectly neutralize this acid with a strong base and you eat up all of those HAs, unlike the strong acid-base neutralization where all you have is H2O at equilibrium, at the end point, at the equivalence point, unlike a strong acid-base neutralization, I'm still going to have conjugate base, but this time that conjugate base is a strong conjugate base. So the presence of that strong conjugate base, the presence of that A minus, in this specific example, it's nitrite, the presence of that strong conjugate base at equivalence point is going to actually raise the pH. If we take a look at what that looks like in terms of a titration curve, again, here's what's absolutely nuts. This is a fuzzy-wuzzy moment. This is an anxiety moment. You should be going, wait, what the flip did he just say? The equivalence point is still the equivalence point, ladies and gentlemen. The equivalence point is still when I have added enough hydroxide to eat up all of the hydronium that's there in solution. But what is very different about a weak acid being neutralized by a strong base in comparison to a strong acid being neutralized, notice it still takes the same 25 milliliters. It's still the same concept, ladies and gentlemen. It's still how much base did I need to add to get the faintest pink possible of all time so that I've eaten up all of my acid. But this time at equilibrium, ladies and gentlemen, even though I've added enough OH to eat up all of the H plus that was there, that phenomenon hasn't changed. But what has changed is the presence of that strong conjugate base. Now my equivalence point pH is not 7. So if you can remember to a couple minutes ago in this vodcast, I said there's a couple parts of each equivalent or titration curve you're supposed to be comfortable with to know what's what. One of which is what's the pH that we start with. A strong acid, the pH starts down here, not at 3, but at 1. So at the same concentration, the pH is lower because we get all the H's. The other part of the titration curve that you're supposed to know that's different is the beginning part. The beginning part of a strong acid is very flat, whereas the weak acid pops up and then levels off and does this weird kind of hump thing. The third part that you're supposed to know about equivalence point titrations is that for a strong acid base, the equivalence point is right here. The EP, the equivalence point for a strong acid base, would be at 7, not at 8. And again, we're going to get deeper into that in future vodcasts, so don't freak out about that just yet. Just understand that the presence of that kind of base is throwing us off. So that also throws off our acid base titration math, ladies and gentlemen. Because again, our quote unquote new net ionic equation now has equilibrium involved, and there is conjugate base that's going to be there, which is going to throw off our pH. Wait a minute, Mahan. I've been paying attention the last 3-4 lessons. Oh my God, we're back at it again. Oh my God, we're going to have to deal with like ice tables. What? And not only are we going to have to deal with ice tables, guys, but maybe even that other Hendy Hossy thing. So unfortunately, ladies and gentlemen, if we go through these same 5 steps where we think about what's in excess, is it the acid, is it the base that's in excess? Unfortunately, if the acid's in excess, then yes, all of that ice table work that we did for weak acids, or maybe even buffers, comes back. If we have a strong base that's in excess, we're going to handle it just like we did the strong acid, strong base problem, because strong base is what's left, and strong base is strong base. So if you take a look at this problem, ladies and gentlemen, again, super duper scary at first, anxiety through the roof, because oh my God, all these words, all these concentrations, all these thoughts, all these feels. We definitely still have a different net ionic equation than what we did for the strong acid-base neutralization, but it is still a 1-to-1 ratio. And so we're going to follow the same steps here, guys. So don't freak out just yet. We're going to go ahead and get out of our moles of acid into moles of H+, volume times molarity. We're going to go ahead and get out of volume of base into moles of base. Little disclaimer alert there, right? This is the theoretical dissociation that we did in step one, which will only happen if the amount of OH added is greater than or equal to the amount of H that is available. Step two, get out of volume of base, get into moles of base, just like what we did for the strong on strong. Step three, just like what we did for strong on strong, because the strong base long hair don't care. The strong base doesn't care where it gets its H pluses from. All it cares is that it gets an H plus and gets to water. So the H, whether it comes from H plus or from HA, the strong base don't care. It's going to use up H's regardless. So step three is the same. I still subtract my amount of OH from my amount of H, my theoretical amount of H. And just like what we did for that first acid-base titration neutralization, this is going to lead to excess OH. So when we have excess OH, all we're going to do is appreciate the fact that that OH ate up all of the acid, aka it turned the weak acid into a strong acid. It ate up all of the acid, so the acid must have gone to completion. I've used up. There's none left at equilibrium or at the equivalence point. There's zero left. So I'm going to finish this problem just like what we did with the strong on strong. I'm going to divide the moles of base by the total volume. I'm going to say, okay, I believe you. I realize that that's the POH. And then I'm going to subtract that from 14. And what you may notice, ladies and gentlemen, and again, there's just a little bit of method behind the madness of the notes I throw at you that I'm spitting at you. Even though this is a weak acid, and weak acids are weaker than strong acids, even though this is a weak acid that I titrated with a strong base, I end up with the same pH as the strong acid, strong base problem, because it was the same volume of acid with the same molarity of acid. So it was really the same total moles of H. And again, strong bases don't care where they get the H's from. All they care is they get to gobble. All right. What about when we have excess acid? Again, we're going to take that amount of acid. We're going to theoretical how many H's are possible by multiplying volume of acid times volume of volume of acid times molarity of acid. We're going to do the same thing for base. And again, the base doesn't care where the H's come from. So strong bases treat weak acids just like they are strong acids. Now, when I subtract out the OH, now I do have more H's than I do OH's. Now, unfortunately, unlike the strong acid problem, where whatever H is left is our acid, so let's go. Negative log of it, let's go. We got something else very different coming up. What we actually have is the amount of HNO2 left. And if you remember, ladies and gentlemen, that is a weak acid. Therefore, we actually have acid and conjugate base in solution. Therefore, oh my God, we've got crazy ice table math coming our way. So again, what we just discussed, what we just discovered, what we just did via stoichiometry, we've really have been kind of incognito doing this to you as an ice table. We multiplied volume times molarity to get my initial amount of acid. I did volume times molarity of the base. Now, whether we titrated it, whether I created the solution with it to get go, that was our C. I added a base to this acid. It eats up acid. It creates base. And so there's our equilibrium. We would have to divide values by the total volume of the solution. We could divide it by the total volume of the solution, which in this case would have been 55.7 milliliters. And we could then plug those into the Ka statement, reorganize for the concentration of H+. And we can do all of that fun to find our H+, to then finally find pH equals negative log of that H+. Now, previously, when we had been doing weak acids, we were just getting X and X here. And previously, we always ended up with a weak acid that X equals Ka times HA. But I can't do that because through that titration, I actually have some amount of both. And it's not X. It's not X. They're different values. So I actually have to plug in my legitimate concentration of conjugate at base. I have to put in my legitimate concentration of acid, and I have to plug those values actually in to my Ka statement to get a different value for our hydronium. Now that's really, really annoying, and that's a lot of work, and that's a lot of like, oh my God, I'm getting nauseous, right? Wait a minute, wasn't there like something else that was actually created when you have a weak acid with its conjugate, which is exactly what we have when we titrate, where we react a strong base into a weak acid and don't fully neutralize the acid. So in reality, ladies and gentlemen, rather than doing all that fun Ka nonsense and rather than plugging these values in and divide them and find their concentrations, divide by 0.0557 and divide by 0.0557 and then take those numbers and plug it into the K statement and do all that fun stuff we just did. Instead, if you could appreciate the fact that you now have a weak and its conjugate, that you now created a buffer, you could actually then still concentrations. You could actually now just take those concentrations and plug them into our Hendy-Hossi and use the Henderson-Hasselbalch equation to save us a lot of obnoxious math. It's up to you, whatever you'd like to do. All right. Last, I hate teaching cheats, but what I want you to also just walk away from this vodcast with, unfortunately, you do have to be prepared and ready for these net ionic equations. We spent a lot of time on that first one. We did spend even more time on the second one. And I didn't give you the net ionic equation for bases, but if they do ever ask you for a weak base, this is what the net ionic equation for a weak base being titrated with a strong acid is. All right. We're going to continue to drill down into this math and these titration curves over the next 2-3 days. All right, so hang in there, and hopefully as we work through the practice problems, this will make more sense. Thanks for watching.